Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us for week 26 of our series on preventing and managing COVID-19 in the workplace. This is Karen O'Hara, Director of Marketing and Communications with WorkCare. For the duration of the webinar, you will be on mute. Please submit your questions using the Q&A function on the Zoom application. The webinar will last about 40 minutes. And we'll take your questions at the end. We'll also post answers to questions on our website, as always. Any ones that aren't answered will be included in that document, which you can find at workcare.com. You can also find a recording of all these sessions on our YouTube channel. For those of you who are just joining us for the first time, I want to introduce our speaker. And others of you who are with us every week already know him well by now, Anthony Harris, MD, MBA, MPH. Dr. Harris is board certified in occupational medicine. He's our chief innovation officer, our associate medical director for on-site clinical operations, and lead clinician for our COVID-19 response. Thanks again for joining us.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome again to another episode, if you would, of our COVID-19 update. We're excited to talk today to you about vaccinations for COVID-19 and vaccination updates, in general. So what we want to jump into is the format as usual, our clinical update followed by microbiology pathology. We'll touch on and do the numbers with regard to epidemiology of COVID-19 in the U.S. and abroad. Then we'll talk about prevention and finally what the strategy forecast is with regard to workforce with WorkCare as well. So without further ado, we want to talk about today, again, vaccinations and be prepared for a COVID-19 vaccine when the time is right. And one of the things that has been prominent for a number of years now is a kind of public outcry, or in some smaller pockets, a focused effort to decrease vaccinations, if you would. And this is an example of that in this ad here from the Texas for Vaccine Choice, stating that 19.5% of adverse reactions happen in children age 5 and under. Okay, and connecting this directly with vaccinations that children get. And this inevitably is something that I'm sure many of your employees have encountered, have heard, and there is true anxiety out there that we've seen anecdotally, as well as some published data, that people who may have the COVID vaccine available to them come next year or even later this year may not even want to take the vaccine, right? And so we want to address this. We want to look at the data specifically around vaccinations, look at clinically what is the presentation of side effects of vaccines, and we want to be prepared to educate our workforce so that we can do our best as healthcare professionals and health and safety professionals to prevent transmission of COVID-19 in the workplace. And obviously this doubles down with regard to education around flu vaccination during this upcoming flu season. So when we talk about then the different types of reactions that may happen as a result of vaccinations, let's distill them each here in three levels, if you would. Localized level first, being just soreness, redness, some itching and swelling that can happen around the site of injection. These are not too uncommon in terms of side effects and certainly are short-lived. Bleeding sometimes might be present. And again, that's the reason why most of the time you get your shot and immediately hold pressure with a Band-Aid or a cotton ball over the site. The remedy to this common localized effect is a cold compress or using some anti-inflammatories like ibuprofen, okay? The next level, if you would, is a little bit more prominent. Fright or syncope is a response when someone gets an injection that is a systemic response. And it doesn't necessarily mean that the drug or material itself is causing their response, but it is a response nonetheless to the needle. You all heard and may have even seen individuals who have a particular aversion to needles. And certainly we've had our share in the clinic as we administer vaccines of administering a shot, and within a couple seconds, the person gets cold and clammy and then kind of clamps down and passes out for a second. That does happen. But again, it's not secondary to the drug or material itself. It's more of a fight or flight response to the needle. And in addition to that, some of the other things that can happen are the dizziness, lightheadedness that precede anybody passing out. Again, we just want to be cognizant of these type of responses. And that's it all arises from how our bodies are, again, kind of wired from our systemic wiring. We won't get into details of the fight or flight response, but just know that it is a reaction, but it's not related directly to the drug and material. Anaphylaxis is, however, related to the drug or material itself. It is the most severe, if you would, of reactions, and it can cause death, right? But it's exceedingly uncommon. Anaphylaxis is a rapid systemic response, usually some pre-created allergy in the individual itself to a particular substance of the vaccine. And certainly clinicians are trained to help prevent this type of adverse response by asking a series of questions, right? And so when we talk about this, the severity of this type of response and reaction, we want to educate our workforce that it is uncommon and that there are precautions that take place to help prevent severe response. And again, anything that's been approved through FDA has undergone extensive testing to make sure that this type of side effect or response is very minimal. Okay, so those are the three different levels. And so let's get a little bit more specific in terms of clinical response to vaccinations as a means of side effects. And if we look at a very common vaccine, a Tdap or DTaP, this is a commonly given to children, obviously required in most states and jurisdictions. And what we see in terms of the CDC reported side effects include that local response, the swelling, the tenderness, and then a fever, feeling tired, a loss of appetite, and sometimes even vomiting, right? The more serious reactions being seizure, high fever, and then rarely swelling in the arms or legs that are more than just that localized response. Okay, very rarely a long-term seizure or coma or lowered consciousness is seen. But again, these things are exceedingly rare, and we'll speak to those numbers here shortly. If we look at another type of common vaccination is the flu vaccine that we're talking about in this season. And there's two different types of flu vaccinations. In general, there's inactivated vaccine, where the virus itself can cause, or is the virus and the material in the immunization itself can cause some local redness and swelling, like we talked about, that local response. But some people may experience this phenomenon called Guillain-Barré, GBS. And that is essentially a response to the vaccine material itself. It's typically short-lived, right? But it can cause some concerning paralysis, usually of the face, okay? I personally know some patients as well as friends who have had that in response to a vaccine, and you can also get it just on its own, by itself, without a vaccine. So it is a phenomenon that's well documented, but uncommon. Children can also have, along with the flu shot, some seizure risk as well. But again, being very uncommon. And again, providers are looking for these type of responses during and immediately after administration of the flu vaccine. The other general type of flu vaccine is a live vaccine, and a live attenuated vaccine. It can cause runny nose, congestion, wheezing, and vomiting as well, as we mentioned. But what you don't see is a side effect of actually having the flu, okay? You'll hear that rumor out there that the flu vaccine gave me the flu. But that is not a side effect of any of these preparations. So you may have symptoms that may mimic early flu or mild symptoms that may mimic a cold, like we're talking about now, but they are in fact not the flu itself, okay? So we want to specify that so that we can educate accordingly. If we look at then, look at the numbers of incidents for these type of side effects, this study back in 2004 was conducted and it sought out to enumerate the side effects from common vaccinations, in this case amongst a pediatric or kids population. And so their methods looked at over a 6-month period prospectively, the response that was captured from 946 children ranging from the age of 0 to 14. And what they saw was that about 19% of the children studied ended up having some type of reaction or response, okay? The responses included, adverse reactions included edema, which is just that local swelling, pain at the site of inoculation, a subjective fever, meaning the parents thought the kids had a fever, and then an actual measured elevated temperature or fever, okay? And so these responses are common, 19% again, but they're common for the mild symptoms, not the severe symptoms. So we want to allay concerns of our workforce that they're going to have some adverse response to a coming flu vaccination, likely as well COVID-19 vaccination, as these vaccines have very similar formulations as well as very similar preparations, okay? So let's talk about some of the pathology. Let's get down to how these vaccines are made, and that will help inform us of a likely COVID vaccine and its potential side effects. So again, that we can educate accordingly. So when we talk about the flu vaccine, there are certain types of flu vaccines, specifically more than the general two that we mentioned earlier. There's a trivalent flu vaccination. It's designed to have a little stronger response, particularly approved for those who are 65 and older. High dose is same thing. We want to target those who are vulnerable, 65 and over. The kind of standard dose is what we are using, the quadrivalent flu vaccination. These are usually grown in eggs, right? And we talked previously about how viruses are made. We'll revisit that briefly during this talk so that we're all and continue to be on the same page. But these are a number of different manufacturers, right, that produced the flu vaccination for 2020. They're approved for children 6 months or older for a lot of them, and some of them are not, right? If we look at the quadrivalent cell-based vaccine, specifically for those who may have an egg allergy, these are egg-free preparations of the flu vaccination, okay? If we look at recombinant quadrivalent flu vaccinations, these are also egg-free, but they're only approved for those who are 18 or older, okay? So we want to make sure that, again, we're educating on options for flu vaccinations for anyone who says, well, I have an egg allergy, so I can't get my flu shot, right? That is not true. There are preparations that will do fine with them in terms of prevention as well as side effect profile. So when we talk about updating and revisiting some of the data that we presented previously on vaccines, we talked about the Chinese effort on some very promising data. It was way back in June, right, that we talked about their vaccination protocol that was in phase one and phase two that had promising results. And those results saw that there were no serious reactions or adverse reactions to the vaccine for SARS-CoV-2 or COVID-19, and the virus was producing at a rate of 100% neutralizing antibodies after two doses, Okay. And so again, that gave us some early indication on the potential success of COVID-19 vaccinations that were being prepared both locally and abroad. So let's talk about briefly again, revisiting how vaccines are made. Typically, inactivated viruses are made by bombardment of the virus with radiation, so to speak. And that radiation kills the virus and inactivates it. But what's present on the virus still are the little proteins that can cause a response and allow us to be immunocompetent against the virus. Commonly, hepatitis A, flu, and polio are made this way. When we talk about then SARS-CoV-2, the way they're being made in part and partial is this methodology. And then the vaccine is, once it's administered to an individual, our antibodies then recognize those proteins that are on the surface of that inactivated virus, okay? And the goal is one of two ways, and most of the time with COVID-19, we're looking for the first of these two ways, the blocking or neutralizing antibody, okay? This antibody recognizes the virus, attaches itself, and prevents the virus from replicating and gaining access into the human cell. Okay, and that's what we're talking about with blocking and neutralizing antibody. The other type of antibodies recognize that the cell has been infected and goes and basically signals the cell to apoptose or die. Okay, but we're looking at, for the most part with COVID-19 vaccines, the formation of neutralizing or blocking antibodies. And so when we look at one of the leading vaccines out there, hopefuls, we visited this a couple weeks ago, the Oxford vaccine trial. They're using chimpanzees with an adenovirus. They're taking that adenovirus, which is different from the SARS-CoV-2, and they're placing SARS-CoV-2 proteins, in short, in the adenovirus. That causes that adenovirus to produce proteins on its surface that are the same as SARS-CoV-2. And that's administered to an individual. Those cells then start to express that protein, and our antibodies then form against those proteins, okay? And that's what allows us to have an immune response if and when exposed to COVID-19, the native COVID-19 in the general population, okay? And if we look then at the leader, one of the leaders here, again, Oxford being, that Oxford trial being one of them, they still are in that phase two, phase three trial in the UK and abroad. We talked about their study in Brazil and introducing to the tunes of thousands of patients this vaccine and having a good response so far. So we want to, again, continue to pay attention to some of these trials, how these vaccines are made, so that we can be conversant with employees who have questions. So let's do the epidemiology of our update for today. If we look at the U.S., we were last week at 6 million, just over 6 million cases, 184,000 deaths. If we fast forward to today, we're up to 6.2, almost 6.3 million cases and 188,000 deaths. Now, if you look at that trend from where we were, it is trending down. And in fact, as we look at this new chart here today, that shows the six most commonly cited states that were hard hit by COVID-19, California, Florida, Georgia, Illinois, North Carolina, and Texas, looking at their trend over a seven-day rolling average for a number of cases reported to CDC, we can see that there is, in general, a downward trend, right? We had a spike here several days ago, approximately 10 to 20 days ago, right? But then, in general, since then, we've been trending back down, and certainly that is the trend that we've seen across states here just recently. If we look then more broadly at the U.S. and how we're doing, this is how we were on August 26th, 2 weeks ago. When we looked at it last week, we were kind of flattening the curve here. And today, We're seeing a downward slope here of the number of cases over a 7-day rolling average nationwide. If we look at then the number of deaths, 2 weeks ago, we saw a little bit of a decrease, maybe a little flattening, and that trend has continued from last week to this week with the downward trend on deaths as well. So obviously, positive news in regards to overall how we're faring in the U.S. abroad. And if we look at then our share of positive tests, again, we watch this metric to understand, are we testing enough to articulate the burden of illness in the U.S., or are these decreasing, this trend of decreasing cases only secondary to a decrease in the testing that we see, right, and that's actually being conducted? So to answer that question, we look at this metric, and we saw 2 weeks ago where we were, the United States kind of hanging out just there under India, but certainly far from our neighbors across the pond, Germany, Norway, New Zealand, who were down in the range of 0.2 to 0.3 percent cases per their rate of positives over a 7-day rolling average. And again, we want to trend downward for this metric. We were flat and spiked a little bit last week. If we look at this week, we're continuing to be a little higher than we were previously. If we want to get specific and look at our numbers, we're at 5.3%, meaning 5.3% of the tests that we are conducting in the U.S. are positive for COVID-19. And that is up a little bit from where we were last week and the week before, but certainly lower than India, South Africa, Indonesia, but much higher than our neighbors across the pond. So we need to continue to increase the number of tests so that number decreases and we are assured that we're articulating the burden of illness accurately here in the U.S. If we look at the number of COVID tests conducted daily over the last 7-day rolling average, this is where we were last week, trending downward, okay? And we all knew about the news of CDC announcing, hey, don't test so much asymptomatic individuals. And we want to pay attention to this metric because we're continuing to be a little lower than we were weeks ago, okay? And so we were trending, again, exponentially on an increasing slope, and now we're flat or and decreasing. So hopefully, the new approved antigen test, the new approved point of care test with Abbott will help spur a new surge in terms of testing, particularly as we try to reopen schools, universities that have had to close down again recently. And this today exemplifies from last week, looking at this metric from last week, the decrease that we were seeing here. So when we talk about vaccines and prevention, we got to get a realistic picture of where we are now and where we're going to be in the next coming weeks and the coming months, right? We've all heard, I don't want to call it rhetoric, but we've all heard the announcement of a potential vaccine by November from the White House. And so let's look at the data. Excuse me. Let's look at the data and what the clinical professionals in the U.S. are saying around, are we going to have a vaccine or not? Because if we are, great, we need to be prepared for it for the workforce. If we are not, then we need to also be prepared for continuing on the path that we're on with regard to our preventative strategy. So if we look at what Tony Fauci has said about the likelihood of a vaccine by election time, he said unlikely, okay? Specifically, he said that the corona vaccine for the U.S. probably won't be ready before November in the presidential election, all right? If we look at another individual who we talked about before, who heads up the Warp Speed effort, we mentioned that pertaining to the billions of dollars that were poured into the vaccination efforts by the U.S. government, which is a subpart of the CDC. The Warp Speed head, Salawi, said that it is extremely unlikely, but not impossible, that a vaccine will be ready by early November. The Warp Speed being the multi-billion-dollar effort here. But he also said that the evidence that's being presented so far is more hopeful than he anticipated. To expect potentially an EUA or emergency authorization that could happen around October, okay? If we look at then a counter to that, Pfizer's CEO said, although they're expecting good data so far and preparing for an FDA submission, it might not be until late October that they actually make a decision in that regard. So again, unlikely that we're going to have a vaccine that's out by the election in early November. If we look at this chart that we've presented multiple times now to get a good idea of the leaders in regard to hopefuls for vaccines, we have now seven total that are in the phase 3 clinical trial. There is some evidence that there are two more out there in phase 3, a total of 9. But we continue to try to uncover those other players here from a global standpoint. But we have Moderna that is a hopeful. We have the Oxford that we talked about that's hopeful, and Pfizer's effort as well. If we look then to try to understand, are these vaccines going to be safe, right? What are the risks from a adverse reaction standpoint, specifically for COVID-19? It is expected in the clinical community that the COVID-19 vaccine will cause some side effects, right? Is that alarming? No, right? Because we know that vaccines in general can cause mild side effects, but specifically, are these side effects enough to affect some of the efforts that are underway right now in clinical trials? And what we know is that this study or this article, just as recent as July, spoke to Cambridge Moderna's effort, as well as the Chinese manufacturer stopping their high-dose trials because of some side effects. And that Chinese vaccine was the one I presented earlier in the talk today, and they did, in fact, stop their high-dose vaccination back when we presented it earlier this summer. But again, they stopped it because of side effects. So again, the reassuring fact here is that yes, these pharmaceutical companies are being very cautious with regard to their safety profile, which is what we want to communicate to those who are concerned about a COVID-19 vaccine. Furthermore, let's look at this article that was published in The Lancet here. And this article specifically did a study looking at the Oxford COVID preparation for their vaccine, and looking at whether or not it was causing any side effects, and also looking at some of the efficacy, okay? And so they compared a male and female, 543 individuals who received the vaccination. When they looked at that particular preparation, they found that the common side effect was pain, fever, chills, muscle aches, headache, and malaise, okay? There were no serious adverse effects from this particular preparation. And furthermore, from an efficacy standpoint, they found that neutralizing antibodies were produced in about 91% of individuals when tested with one methodology, and 100% of individuals when using an alternative methodology for detecting the neutralizing antibodies. Again, positive news that not only can the vaccine be safe, but it also is efficacious for producing immunity when administered. In this case, it was two doses followed by a booster was the protocol that was used for this vaccine. If we look at, unfortunately, then what happened with AstraZeneca, they halted just recently one of their study, okay? And they halted it because of a side effect that happened as a result of one individual having severe response. And it's still not uncovered as to what that reaction is. and represents. And that's the due diligence that they're undergoing right now, okay? But it is definitely affecting their trial in that it's halted and for an unknown length of time. But it's not a situation where they've announced that the vaccine will not continue in the phase three trial. So we'll continue to pay attention to this leading hopeful for a vaccine here. And if we look at then the response from pharma in general, the leaders for COVID-19 vaccinations have recently come together this week and announced that they have pledged to not release any vaccine that doesn't meet their kind of collective standard on safety. Obviously, they have to meet FDA safety profiles, but also just a announcement of stringent safety precautions that they are taking to ensure to the general public and population that the COVID-19 vaccination will be safe first and foremost, okay? So again, a lot of attention being paid to safety, communication of safety, and watching clinical trials of these hopefuls here. So what do we do in our community as the responsible parties for our workforce in regards to the prevention of COVID-19 and flu and other infectious illness in the workplace, right? And so education is going to be key. And if you have not started preparing your education materials, we need to help you in that effort, because promoting vaccination in the workplace is something that is well supported by CDC. This education material being provided by CDC, right? And even as far as providing benefits directly to your employees, communicating that not only can it improve your health and wellness overall, but just the sheer convenience of being at the workplace and receiving a vaccination, or obviously with the workforce still working remotely here, having a central location that they can still practicing social distancing, come and get their vaccination and hopefully protect themselves and their families. And then when we talk about the support and benefit for the employers, obviously it is a cost saver by decreasing absenteeism, a cost saver by increasing productivity. And these are reasons why as employers, we wanna make sure we're doing our best to try to provide these type of resources to our employees. If we look at then other materials that is widely available here, again, from CDC, even details on how to host a flu vaccination clinic, right, are available here for us. And again, as a resource, we're helping our employers prepare for vaccinations, not just for the flu, but for COVID-19 when we have one, a vaccine available. And it's just going to allow us to more seamlessly extend these resources to our employees and reap the benefits, again, that we spoke about here briefly. So if you need materials, we're going to start publishing these materials to our employers so that we have a concerted effort to educate not just on safety, but on the benefits of these vaccinations as they come forward. CDC does a good job of and FDA does a good job of requiring all clinicians to educate patients before vaccines are administered. And we want to share that those details with you as employers so that we're all concertedly educating employees and promote vaccination. So we don't have the situation that some fear, the vaccine being widely available for COVID-19 and only a minority of individuals who are willing to partake, which obviously will lead to a big gap in terms of those who are immune and delay a kind of back-ended recovery from a national standpoint in this pandemic. So with that, we'll stop and we'll open it up to questions. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Harris. A number of the questions you've already answered by addressing, especially there were questions about the AstraZeneca-Oxford testing. So we won't address those now, but there's a couple others that are not related to the vaccine that we can jump into. One person wants to know if you could provide an update on saliva testing. What's the availability of it?
Sure. So saliva testing is becoming more and more available. Work Care ourselves, we've been offering saliva testing for about 8 weeks now. And the process is pretty straightforward in that we can provide it in bulk shipment to you, the employer, for you to distribute appropriately to your workforce, or we can direct mail and ship a test accordingly to individual employees. Obviously, the bulk option has been what has played out more prominently. And there are more and more labs preparing their analysis for saliva. And it's all tied to the sensitivity of these tests as the science has improved, the technology has improved. The sensitivity is such that saliva now is far more available with many labs, in addition to the protocol that was published and the reagents that were published recently that allowed laboratories to do saliva testing at a fraction of the cost. We're talking about $4 to $5 per test. And so we know that saliva will continue to grow an opportunity for us to provide testing. And then in addition to that, if we look towards kind of the next step of it, which is pool testing, there are now three approved laboratories and tests for pool sampling. Okay, actually four, I apologize, four. Quest being one of them, LabCorp being another, and the University of California being one as well. And so these tests now are sensitive enough so that samples can be pooled together and we can offer testing at a fraction of the cost for our workforce. And we'll provide some updates on that in the weeks to come.
Okay, great. Regarding the vaccine, do any show there may be viral shedding after vaccination?
So far, I have not seen any data as to whether or not individuals still shed the virus. Are you speaking towards an individual who's contracted and recovered COVID-19 and subsequently receives a vaccine, or individuals who have never encountered COVID-19 and received a vaccine? If the latter is the case, there is very little to no likelihood, because of the inactivation of the virus itself, that an individual would actually shed virus, right? To do so would mean that somehow the inactivated virus caused an active infection and subsequently replication in the individual, which would then lead to shedding of the virus itself. But again, the preparations that we've looked at, all the either the virus has been inactivated, or it's a preparation that doesn't even use virus itself and just only the proteins from the virus that is used, as we talked about with the Oxford vaccine itself.
Okay. Here's a question we've never been asked, and it's a good one, I think. Are home injuries on the rise due to the stay-at-home schedules? If so, do we have a reputable data source that we can share?
That is definitely a topic for another talk here. The question was, are home injuries on the rise as a result of the stay-at-home order? I have not specifically looked at the rate of home injuries as a result, but certainly one would postulate that the answer is yes. We know that ergonomics has been an issue for home, and ergonomic injuries have risen in the home as opposed to the workplace. But across the board, looking at specific injuries that have increased, we have not done that analysis, but certainly one that's interesting and, like I said, probably a good topic for another talk.
Yeah, so I wonder if the National Safety Council might be able to offer us some information. But I thought that was a good question. I know if you trip over your cat, that would count, I guess. You know, we're all working around our pets and our children, and there's lots of potential hazards here in the home office.
Indeed.
I guess we kind of need to wrap up. There's other questions. A lot of them I would encourage you all to look back at past Q&As because a lot of your questions we've already answered, and so we don't typically take time during the call to re-answer them, but we want to make sure all your questions get answered. I guess my final question would be, and to sort of summarize a lot of the questions we've received, is what if Dr. Harris looks in his crystal ball and what your prediction is for when we actually could realistically expect a vaccine to be widely available in the United States?
Sure. So let's go the optimistic route. Let's say optimistically we have a vaccine that receives FDA emergency use authorization this year, by the end of this year. What that means is that vaccine will, as it has been with the COVID-19 test, consumed to the order of millions by the federal government. We've seen the federal government procure and basically take about 1.5 to 2 million of the tests, first 2 million of the tests that are available. Likewise, we anticipate the government will sequester a vast number of the available vaccine for its use. Then after that, available to hospital groups, large healthcare organizations, hopefully WorkCare being one of them, and then to the general population through your personal physician outlets. That's not going to happen very likely until either late next spring or even in the summer if we're talking about an EUA approval this year. So many institutions are not expecting full kind of recovery back to a in-person presence until fall of next year as a result of that vaccine potential timeline.
Okay, and then to answer quickly a question about the flu information that you just shared, we'll be posting that soon on our website and sharing it with our clients. And we already have quite a bit of information about flu planning available. So again, please visit our resources page. Thank you, Dr. Harris, and thank you all for joining us again this week. We'll see you next Wednesday.
Every week's a pleasure. Everybody, thank you. Stay safe.
Take care.